So I go to the NASA website and we get this. Oops. It's unavailable. Now, due to the lapse in federal government funding, this website is not available. Now, does anybody else find it kind of strange that you see this USA.gov? You have a comet above between the U and the S? You see that line and that star? I mean, does anyone find that just a little bit interesting? So is anybody out there besides myself a little bit concerned that the logo, the official logo of the US.gov shutdown has this comet above it? I mean, where in our history do we have this line with a star, the line, obviously a comet? Where exactly does that come from? You know, historically, is that something like, oh, people say, oh, of course, that's what we always use for this. What? The shutdown, NASA is not available, and we're not getting any information from space at this time. Hello? Well, certainly, I have been shown quite some time ago, I've known all my life, that there's going to be a problem from a comet. We just say we don't know which one, and I can't say for sure that it's ISON. But the circumstantial evidence is adding up. But there again, it's possible it will pass. It's also possible it won't pass without incident. But the government is acting in a very strange way, that's for sure. It's almost like a manufactured shutdown of the government, really. I mean, the stalemate that's going on is really ridiculous. It's phony. It feels phony to me. It's the perfect excuse for a blackout, isn't it? Perfect excuse for a blackout. It's very odd what is going on. A lot of automated stuff, government's automated, that's already paid for, is also shut down. So the shutdown seems to be strategic for various reasons. So, you know, hold on to your, buckle your seatbelts and hold on to your hat. It seems as though we're going into very much the Twilight Zone, which we are. The whole thing has become surreal. Why does the shutdown, US.gov, have this comet above it? Shutdown because of the comet? You know, it's. Are they trying to tell us something there? Someone has a sense of humor. Someone's, you know, tipping us off. Some, right? So, in looking at how I've been tipped off throughout history, my life, definitely I've been tipped off that either an asteroid or a comet, something that we expect their trajectory will make a safe passage past us. What happens is something knocks it off course. Somehow it gets pushed into a collision with the Earth. Space rocks coming in and hitting the planet. That's what I have been shown. I think it's intentional, that there's a way to intentionally alter the course of these events. So again, is it ISON? I don't know. Probably, you know, but maybe not. But in any hand, what is needed is a true centering, and we're going to talk about that next. One of the things that the great teachers tell you is that there is no I, there is no little self. The realization of no self is what happens to the great mystics, the great realizers, the realization of no self. And we can do that too. We can do that too. There isn't any quote-unquote little self. an I. It's a presumption. It's basically used, it's a defensive device to get us to avoid stepping into the purity of the instant, the holy instant that the Holy Spirit has for us. Because what we tell ourselves is, well, we need to give this to something other than ourselves. I say, well, this is great for me, but I need to give it to the I. How do I give this to the I? How do I give it, symbolize it so the I can also have it? But there is no I. There isn't anyone you give it to. When you have an experience of the holy instant, of the seamless new vision of neutrality and oneness of perception, you perceive this. And then you think, okay, but now how do I give this to myself? You know, there isn't any other self other than the self that we already are. We're thinking, how do I use this to help the little self grow? There is no little self, actually. There isn't any I or little self. And that's a realization that quite a few have had throughout history, and we need to get to that actually at this time, because the whole situation in the world has become alarmingly odd and strange, surreal. And this comet is coming in at a time which is very suspicious, actually. Very suspicious. The ability to step into purity comes from relinquishing the belief that there is some, that you are nurturing another, a new self. Okay, there's never been any new self. We've not been nurturing anything, actually. It's just a supposition. It's a hypothetical. It's like a wish, a fantasy, actually. The shock probably is that when you enter into the perfect vision, the perfect know of the Holy Spirit, the no to the death training program, no, you cannot die, you never train yourself to die, is that there isn't any call for you to externalize that to some quote-unquote self. And you think, oh my gosh, what happened to myself? How come it's not communicating to me? Because there is no self. There is no little self. That's why it's not communicating. But we assume, oh, I better, what's happened? Has it gone comatose or something? No, it's never been there in the first place. So we think maybe we killed the self, but the fact is it's never been there. How can you kill the self? It's never been there. How can you kill the I? It's never been there. How can you kill the ego? It's never been there. It's all been a supposition, a fantasy of the future, actually. We keep fantasizing the future. The goals we have are always in the future. We're going to reach it in the future, in the future, in the future, in the future. And it's always this way. It's always this way. On and on and on and on and on. Yeah, we're almost there, but it's the future. It's in the future. No, there is no self. There is no I. There's nothing to share the experience with. Nothing to nurture. We're the ones who need to be nurtured by this vision. So, what maybe diverts us away from this is thinking, oh my gosh, I killed the self. How could I do that? Now, there isn't any self, little self. There isn't any. How can you kill it? It's never been there. But you say, well, I'm trying to give birth to it. And so this is abortion. Now, we're trying to give birth to death, and we can't do it. So we've never actually taken the first step towards doing it. So it's not an abortion. So these things need to be cleared out of our psyches, that we're not killing anything. What's that? We're not aborting anything. And speaking of that, insect flying as a moth. But today I was working, and suddenly we saw this large, huge insect walking. It's like, what? It was a praying mantis. It was a huge praying mantis. I haven't seen a praying mantis. I don't know if I've ever seen it in the wild. can't remember if I ever have or not. This was a gigantic praying mantis. And it is really, really something. And I said, oh, I wish I had my camera, because I would take a picture. And I said, this is the first day I've not brought my camera in years and years and years. It's really weird. And then after it had gone, I looked in the truck, and I did have my camera. I said, wow, strange, very strange. I got weird, scared. The praying mantis is a very scary insect, actually. It's just so bizarre and huge, and the way it turns its head like a snake head and everything. It's like, wow. Interesting. This comet Ison is supposed to have a head to it. The nucleus, and then in front of the nucleus is this, somehow it's gassing also forward off the head of the nucleus, as if there's some body in front of the nucleus, like a head. Now, actually, I think ancient people talked about angels when they saw comets, because comets can take on this appearance, the way they draw angels with this kind of light head and then a body like a gown streaming away from it. If you look at some of the pictures of comets and you compare them to pictures of angels throughout history, they're very, very, very similar. And they talk about angels flying through the heavens, you know. Those are comets, actually. It's also trumpets that the angels use. They said the trumpets are also a comet. You look at a comet and it's nucleus, and then it streams away in its trail, and it gets wide at the end. It's like a trumpet. So the trumpets sounding, or angels sounding trumpets, etc., talking about comets, I believe. And Revelation is talking about comets coming in. Ison, yeah. So we are needing to step into the purity of the holy moment, the instant, the instantaneousness of neutrality, pure art, as it were, without any symbolization of it. And we do this by realizing that there isn't any self that has to die for us to do this, and therefore we're not killing anything by stepping into purity, and we're not aborting anything, and we're not losing any creativity, because there's nothing there in the first place. How can we be losing creativity? It's not like we're saying, like, oh, our efforts to nurture something has been foiled. No. We cannot nurture the birth of death. It's impossible. I had a terrible dream last night. I was woken up by a nightmare at 4 o'clock. And I tell you, this one was truly scary. Shocked me. I've been reverberating all day from it. And it basically showed what's going on in the world, and has been going on, what's going to happen. And I found out we're trapped in a certain way. There's this gunman opened up. It was a female, actually. It was a very raunchy strumpet of a woman who has been putting on a raunchy show for the world for a long time, distracting our attention away, actually. So we're in a position to see that raunchy show, and then suddenly she got up and she started opening fire on people, and gunning them down. I was fleeing. And it's funny, I was fleeing with this cat. It was a fat cat. So I imagine they talk about the fat cats, rich people or something. They're fleeing, and I was looking for an escape. And the direction that I had to go in would be away from the gunwoman. I saw some possibilities of escape, but there was these steel wire fences everywhere. And I tried to lift them up, and they had cables, tension cables on the bottom. You couldn't get underneath them. Everything was fenced off. And I said, whoa, we're trapped. We're really trapped. So during today, I've been thinking about this, and I realized what the solution is that very, very simple, actually. Very clever what the ego's done. If you look at the history, what's gone on the last 50 some odd years, etc., if you've been living through it, you're very aware that these very raunchy strumpets have appeared on the scene. And this whole culture has become super raunchy. And what it is that there is an escape, but it's to go in a direction where you go in that direction, you won't be seeing this raunchy show, okay? You won't be seeing it. This whole show is designed to get us in a position so that we can see the show, as it were, and then get trapped into this pen. But if we go in the direction of that and past it, that's actually where freedom is, but we won't be seeing this raunchy show. Okay, so it's very clever, you know, that this raunchiness has been used. I've been very aware of this, to put us in a pen, in a prison, as it were. Then we can be driven into this prison by this gunwoman shooting at us. Now, the shooting could be space debris. Actually, it could be space debris. I'm not sure exactly what that symbolizes, but certainly a very, very, very vicious, slaughterous shooting attack. So let's say there's a stage. We're in a theater. There's a stage, and there's this very raunchy burlesque show or something going on stage, and we go in the audience. We sit down in the seats, and we're watching this, saying, "Huh, you know." It's like, that's kind of, what's going on here? What's going on? What is this all about? Now, the exits are actually right on the side of the stage, each side of the stage. They're exits, and you can get out that way. So, and the exits in back, I mean, in the front of the theater, away from the stage, those are all blocked. So here, the audience is sitting there in the seats watching the stage, and then suddenly the people on the stage start, you know, shooting at the audience, and the audience starts fleeing towards the front of the theater. I mean, the back part of the audience, that area, away from the stage, fleeing away from the stage, and they're all blocked, and they're all trapped and they're slaughtered. Now, the smart thing to do, if you're in the audience, and we all are in this world, there's been this big show, and you know what I'm talking about, and it continues on with these strumpets who are just putting on extremely raunchy behavior, and of course the media and entertainment is just putting them up there constantly. Oh, how scandalous, oh, how terrible, everybody's watching, everybody's fascinated by that. And that's all by design. It's a trap. What we need to do is go to the exits on the side of the stages and exit there. Now, if we do that, we won't be seeing the show, okay? What we're doing right now is we're backing away from the stage, you know, to the back rows of the audience, saying, well, I gotta get some distance from this, but we can still see it. So, but then when the attack comes, we'll have no choice but to flee to the exits behind the back row of the audience, which, and those are all blocked. They're all blocked. That's what I found in the dream. They're all blocked, all fenced off. Penned in, absolutely penned in. It was terrible. And by the way, the fat cat went underground. They have underground bunkers, actually. So don't go the direction the fat cats are going in. I was fleeing with the fat cat, and I said, wow, okay, maybe I'm going in the right direction, because they're going with me there. And then they went underground, and I was not able to. I was trapped. So the thing to do, again, if we just back to the back row of the audience, we're still watching the raunchy show, and we're still saying, what in the world are these strumpets, you know, what's going on with them? They're behaving so bizarrely, you know, but it's still an intrigue there, still an intrigue. The raunchiness of it is an intrigue. You know, what are they going to do next? The right thing to do is go down to the front row, as it were, on the sides, and then go out the exits on the side of the stage, and then you're not seeing any raunchy show at all, but you're free. You're not going to be trapped. So this is very crucial information, actually, of how to escape what is coming. And it's like stepping into pure art. So stepping into the purity of pure art is the escape, really. It's such a profound escape that it opens the door to any and all escape. So we're focusing in on this step that the mystics have taken, the realization of no self. If there's never been a self there, how could you have killed it by stepping into the purity of it, purity of the Holy Spirit? You're not killing anything. Nothing's being overcome or destroyed or defeated or anything. There's been nothing there to defeat. That's only been our wish, our presumption, that in the future we'll meet our own defeat. Okay, the defeat that we're looking for is our own defeat, actually. And we assume there's someone, something there that's going to bring it about. There is nothing there that's going to bring about our defeat. Okay, this little eye, this self, little, that there's something there with the power to kill us, to defeat us, to destroy spirit, what we are. It's our own fantasy, but there is nothing there. It's a future fantasy, thinking in the future we will meet up with this power that's more powerful than we are and is going to destroy us. No such thing. No such thing. So now you have the inside scoop of why has there been this parade of these raunchy strumpets on the stage of this earth? And you know, they started coming in, what was it, like the 60s started in the 70s, and it got really going with the, it just cascaded on and on and on and on and on and on. They're teaching, you know, the world how to dress very raunchily, how to act raunchily, and this is all part of this trap that's being set for us, I guarantee you. And I experienced it in the dream, and it was horrible. It was absolutely horrible. It was just slaughter. People were just shooting fish in a barrel. We were being slaughtered. So there's a very strong practical side to this step into purity. Step into purity. If you're an artist, step into pure art. Completely pure art. But there's no representation of it. Your experience is the art. You are experiencing pure art. You're not representing it to some imaginary self to try to nurture it so that it can destroy you at some future time. There isn't any such happening. It's never going to happen. So we are getting there, I'm telling you that. And these nightmares and stuff, I was very upset. I needed sleep. I haven't had any sleep. It's been terrible. And I get woken up by this terrible nightmare. So this is, you know, something that's super important actually for us. We are in these terrible times, actually. We've been set up. And I've been talking about it my whole life, telling people, you know, we got to stop this. This is terrible. These raunchy strumpets need to be put down. They need to be admonished. They need to be, you know, not allowed access to mass media and all this kind of stuff. We're headed for huge, huge trouble. And of course, the Antichrist. Let's take the gloves off, since they've taken the gloves off. The Antichrist is the one that's presenting all of this. Okay, and putting it, the entertainment and media industries have put all this stuff center stage intentionally because they work for the Antichrist on this planet. Absolutely. They are attempting to, they're trying to push us, keep us believing in a future where we can actually be destroyed. That's their objective, of course. That's the ego. The ego, the backbone of this, and we call it the ego. Remember, the ego is only our own wish that we find our own destruction, but we'll never find it. We find destruction of the body all the time, which is just the rearrangement of atoms, but we never find spiritual death, actually. Never. Never, 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 never. So there is no such future self. There is no future self. There's only the self that's here this instant. And then people call that self-realization. Self-realization, realizing there's only one self. That's why Jesus said, I am the only one. I am the one. There's no other savior other than the true self. There is no other self at all. No future self. Nothing that needs to be nurtured. Nothing that needs to be died, to be killed. You know, it's not there. We're simply continuously inventing a plausible storyline to keep believing that it's there. We'll find it. So all we're doing is we're telling a story about how we are searching for this self and how we're going to find it. But we never do find it because it's not there. We just keep coming up with plot twists and turns. We're all scriptwriters. The mind is the great scriptwriter of the story, and we're intrigued about. What are we going to see around the next bend? Same thing we've always seen, just more plausible nonsense. So So again, ask yourself, why does the government shutdown have that icon there of a shooting star, you know, or the comet, really? Because the trail is very visible there. That's how you would kind of draw a comet. Why does it have that? Oh, it's shut down because of this comet. Hello? And this comet could bring a lot of debris, and it could bring tribulation period for sure. And it could bring immense martial law, immense slaughter, immense internment in camps, internment camps, re-education camps, all this terrible stuff. When I saw in the dream what was just this incredible slaughter by this very wicked spirit of the Antichrist. And I tell you, it was a female doing the slaughtering. So that's something we're not expecting. But actually, if you've seen the development, what's going on the last 50 years, it shouldn't be surprising at all, as a matter of fact. Not at all. So there is a way out. And we're going to find a way out for sure. And we're virtually there. Virtually there. When we're able to talk about this in such an easy, simple way, and they'd say, okay, there is no future self, so I can't possibly kill myself by abiding in the moment, in the instantaneousness of neutrality. Neutrality must be instantaneous. How can it be not? How could it be take time if there's this perfect, pure neutrality, this instant, everything just as it is right now? It doesn't need time. Time implies something is making a move on something else, right? Neutrality, perfect neutrality, doesn't need any movement to take place. So that, therefore, no movement taking place would only be in this very instant, the instant nirvana, no movement. It is the holy instant. Abide. We can abide in the holy instant, this perfect vision neutrality, which actually cures the continuity problem for us, resolves it. And we can abide in it because of no guilt. No guilt that we have killed our future self, or aborted our future self, because there isn't any future self. And when that can sink in, and we really accept it, then I don't see any reason why we cannot step in into the purity of the holy instant, and motivate others to do the same. And I know it is this guilt, because that's what's caused me so much trouble in my life, is this feeling that I want to do it, step into the holy instant, but I feel this overwhelming guilt, like if I do that, I'm going to let the future self down completely. I won't be there for it, you know, and it's just, it is a horrible guilt, but it's all bogus, entirely bogus. God only has one son, meaning one self, one spirit, not two. Remember, enlightenment is really not an attainment, but a remembrance. The seamless, perfect vision of neutrality, the holy instant, enables us to remember what we really are. Whereas those who reject this are trying to attain a self. They're trying to attain a self. Well, where could that self be except in the future? Where can attainment be except in the future? Think about that. So the holy instant, you don't need any future for that. That doesn't need a future. See, it's that which doesn't need any future at all. So we think, oh my gosh, we killed the future. Or we're not giving any oxygen to the future. It's not. We're not breathing the future. There's no nurturing of the future in the holy instant. Because the time is required for attainment. But remembrance of what we are doesn't require time at all. It doesn't require any attainment. Just remembrance. And since what we are doesn't change at all, we don't need to be viewing all this change or all this future time. We don't need it. So we don't need a vision of time to attain a future self. It's not necessary. All attainment has to be in the future. So we're trying to attain a self in the future. It's not yet with us. But that attainment will never take place. There isn't any success at all at that. Nothing has been built up, actually, at all. Just a jumble of symbols. is all. But as if somehow we're going to be able to breathe a magic incantation into that jumble of symbols and it's become comes alive. Death, no, never. It's just a meaningless jumble of symbols is all we have. That's it. Doesn't matter how those symbols are arranged, really. It's all equally meaningless. Time is all equally meaningless. All attempts to accomplish the impossible are equally meaningless, equally futile. There's no degree of difference among any of those. So this is very important information to go over, because the one thing I've noticed in all the websites about ISON and all that stuff, everybody's freaking out, but they don't have any answers. Say, well, stock up on supplies. Good luck with that. Stock up on supplies. Well, here we have the answer. I've always said you must take a spiritual approach to the situation that's coming up. Most definitely. If you don't need the future, right, the present moment can be extended indefinitely, as it were. I mean, it will be amazed at the power that we have when we're not giving all our power away to the future. We are really trying to give our power away to this future self so it can kill us, destroy us. And so when we stop trying to give all that power away, we remember the power of our mind, the mind, our will and the mind, and we're spirit. We remember that. And then we'll laugh at our fear of all this nonsense. And it goes beyond the scope of what we need to focus on right now, because first things first, which is to get rid of this guilt that we have that's holding us back. We don't do it because we are stopped by something, and this guilt stops us. We think, wow, I don't want to be responsible for murdering my future self. You know, my future lies eventually be a future self, and that future self eventually blah blah blah. You know, no such thing. All future selves we have are still an attempt to bring about this, our own demise. And when we reach that future self, then we're still projecting in the future, like, well, we need something beyond this. Our attainment is not yet complete. We have to keep rearranging symbols, and until somehow we magically, you know, the birth of death occurs. It will never occur. The Holy Spirit knows it will never occur. So there's your ISON update. There's your total update for right now. And we will continue to move forward on this. I mean, these nightmares, I didn't invite them. I came uninvited. And so it's really, things are on ferociously right now. Ferociously. Fortunately, the truth is getting through at this time. The truth is getting through. And we're starting now. We're not starting. We're seeing, wow, how simple it is. There is no future self at all. So there's nothing to lose. We have absolutely nothing to lose by letting go of time. Nothing to lose by let go of time by seeing the vision of perfect neutrality, in which there's no need for any time at all. But the now remains. The now remains. The now extends itself. It's self-extending without trying to have any attainment whatsoever. It's like, so we're ready for that. We're ready for that just in the nick of time, because things are getting absolutely bizarre out there, and people are pointing out how bizarre it's becoming, actually. And it's head-scratchingly bizarre, because so when you come across these websites and you see all this bizarre stuff people are pointing out, just say, okay, fine, but what do I really need to do? I need to you remember, so that it's a spiritual approach. We don't need to attain a self. We need to remember what we already are. We need to, you know, overcome the guilt of letting go of the future, etc., etc. So you can come back here to this website, and you can get this information. And this information really is the prescription. It's the antidote to the times. I say, I will never succeed. This I will never succeed is this imaginary I in the future. And so you have to tell yourself that this imaginary I, there's no possibility of any success or anything happening, or I will never have any chance at greatness. I will never, 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 I will never. And this erodes your belief and expectations towards finding that eye. I will never be found. That's another one. I will never be found. I will never be found. I will never be found. I will never be born. I will never be born. I will never be born. I will never see the light. I will never be found. I will never be found. And this helps a dawning recognition take place. Like, hey, you know what? There isn't any self there in the future. There is. It's not there. It's never been there. It's like chasing after a rainbow. The rainbow is our own desire, really. We're just chasing after the objects of our own desire. And those objects can never be real. And what we're desiring is our own death, spiritual death, so we can be prime creator, at least in our, at least plausibly we think, well, at least that's, at least God is no longer God. If we die, God's not God. So we think, well, then it's possible to replace God. But first we have to get rid of God, so we have to destroy ourselves, which being reality, being one indivisible whole, that would, you know, all of reality would be destroyed. So that's only, it's our desire. We're chasing an object of our desire. But it's not there. Never been there, never will be there. So this should center you in, I will never be found. Go with the I will never. I'll never be found. I'll never be found. I'll never be found. I'll never be found. So I would say, when you watch all these other videos and this freak out is going on, just get back to the simple thing, I'll never, just remember that, I'll never what, I'll never be found, I'll never be free, I'll never be happy, I'll never be real, I'll never be real, there's another one, I'll never be the self, I will never be I will never be I, I will never be I will never be I. It's interesting that the praying mantis look very much like those E.T. Some say that the top E.T.s behind this whole operation look like praying mantises, actually. They're this insectoid type of being with the head. They look like a gigantic praying mantis, and they're the ones who are actually in charge of this whole operation on this planet with the reptilians guiding them, the greys and all of that that's taking place. So seeing that praying mantis, which I said, whoa, you know, it's really on right now. And I got down and looked it right in the eye, and it turned its head and it's looking straight at me with its bug eyes like that, just looking. We just had a face-to-face encounter like that. I said, whoa, wow, it's weird. I mean, the way its head's like this, and it just turns its head like that and just looking right at me, and its front legs are up like that in a fighting stance, you know. And it's, my gosh, this thing. So I said, you know what, it's probably on right now if this praying mantis shows up like that. And I wonder what your thoughts are on that, but it struck me a very ominous note. And also, there are those out there with websites, etc., who their whole motif is this insectoid praying mantis-like motif, and they say they're here to kill all everybody, you know, that's what they're saying, that they're here to chop us into bits, and we're taking over and all this stuff. And so I take it very, very seriously, actually. I believe there are ETs that do look very insectoid ETs, and they really are here to wreak havoc on the situation here, for sure. They're not here to come here and have a cup of tea, you know. I don't think so. So just in the nick of time, we should be able to dispel the false guilt, and then the whole situation resolves for us just like that. And maybe you'll do it before I do it, you know. I hope everybody does right now. Time is getting short for sure, so we will continue on in that direction and just maintain a strong, steady pace. That's it. Okay, I won't see very, very great, because there's no opportunity for I will never have an opportunity to be great. So, how about a very, very ungreat, I will never, how do you end it? You see, I can't say very great anymore, because we're not reaching a state of greatness. Greatness is of the I. We're reaching a state of purity. Okay, and the eye will never reach that. There is, because there is no eye. So all we can do is have hallucinations of greatness. So you might say, okay, for greatness. I'll never have any opportunity for greatness, and that's it.